Let me begin by saying that I am deeply honored to have the opportunity to be in this conference and quite undeservedly to make the keynote address, because I am not an academician, I am not a scholar. In fact, I feel quite an interloper into a conference where such distinguished academics and researchers are present. But even though I may lack the credentials to speak in a formal sense, there are some thoughts which I'd like to share with you. So instead of a keynote address, I'd like to think aloud with you on a subject which I believe is of great importance. It is a subject that must be looked upon not with acrimony, not with the aim of resurrecting the past in order to form new divides, but in a manner which allows for serious introspection, in a manner that allows us to observe, and above all, to create that consciousness and awareness that facilitates change. I say the important this problem is an important problem because the simple truth is that the cultural and intellectual consequences of colonialism do not finish with the gaining of political freedom. It is the basic truth, and the reason for this is that the success of colonialism is not physical subjugation, but the colonization of the mind. And that consequence of colonialism is the least analyzed. The conventional wisdom is that when the Union Jack comes up or the Indian tricolor goes up, a political phase ends, and there is analysis of that political rule. There has been a lot of work on the economic consequences of colonialism, but its continuing impact, in spite of political freedom in the arena of culture and ideas and education, is a subject which is not analyzed fully, not observed fully in the lives that we lead subsequently, and which therefore needs to be focused if we are looking at truly independent and independent thinking. To do this, I think it's first important to understand what was that process inherent in colonialism which created the colonization of the mind. There has to be a rigorous analysis. There cannot be an escape from it. And I don't have time, I have a book which the chairman mentioned called Becoming Indian, which analyzes this in much greater detail. But I'm going to mention three things which are part of colonial strategy and which continue to have enduring consequences. The first was, as part of colonial rule, was the dismissal and derision of the culture of the ruled. And the reason for this was to find the ideological justification for their rule. Now, this derision is not something which is immediately transparent, because in the first phase, when the Britishers came to India, there was a short honeymoon which led to the Asia Society and to William Jones and to some form of respect for the culture that was being ruled. But it soon gave way to an evangelical fervor which led to an institutional, relentless, and pervasive devaluation of the culture of the rule. And it needs study to understand how completely encompassing this was. It has been mentioned in the speeches before, but I will quote random examples to you, but they are not random. They illustrate a conscious trend. And the important thing is that they are not made as arbitrary dicta. They are not made as it was in passing. They are made as knowledge being projected as fact and often put down in writing so that there is no ambivalence. There is no reticence in that critique. Mr. Idris mentioned Macaulay, but Macaulay wrote in his minute, this is not a comment. It came as a result of very conscious thought by a man who himself was exceptionally learned, deeply immersed in the classics and philosophy and literature and thought of his own civilization. And when he came and said that India has medical doctrines which would disgrace an English farrier, astronomy which could move laughter in the girls at an English boarding school, history abounding with kings 30 feet high and reigns 30,000 long years, and geography made up of seas of treacle and seas of butter. And when he says, especially about the Hindus, he says, the Hindus were full of knowledge only of the uses of kusa grass and all the mysteries of absorption in the deity. When the Hindus studied their texts, all they learnt was how to purify themselves after touching an ass, or what text of the Vedas they are to repeat to expiate their crime of killing a goat. I'm quoting an example, but this is not random. His brother-in-law, Trevelyan, George Trevelyan, married to his sister, says, this Macaulay's was a complete dismissal of anything that belonged to Indian culture, but Trevelyan is talking about Indian literature. And he says that when William Jones, in that short-lived honeymoon of some kind of mutual respect, when William Jones compared Kalidas to Shakespeare, Trevelyan countered by saying, and I quote, "The more popular forms of Oriental literature are marked by the greatest immorality and impurity." And one of his contemporaries, the utilitarian James Mill, argued that the lyricism and sentiment in Indian drama was a mark, and I quote again, of a self-indulgent society. And this in turn was, again I quote, the product of a despotic state. Refined people would not, Mill argued, countenance so-and-so in Kalidas's work. Trevelyan was emphatic that the British need not spend any money to publish, and I quote, "erotic Sanskrit dramas teaching lechery in its most seductive forms." This, where literature is concerned. A very established, perhaps the most well-known art critic, George Birdwood, says, and these examples are important because you have to understand the process. Now, talking about Indian sculpture and art and painting, which is a tradition which literally goes back 5,000 years, George Birdwood said, once compared an exquisite Gupta period image of the Buddha to, I quote, to a boiled sweat pudding, and came to the conclusion that in 78 years of study of art, he had not come across anything in India that gave expression, quote, to the good, the beautiful, and the true, unquote. In fact, Birdwood wrote in 1910, as late as 1910, that, and again I quote, sculpture and painting are unknown as fine arts in India, quote, unquote. And then, of course, there is the example of Mr. Lutyens, who built New Delhi and before whom all of New Delhi and elsewhere in India genuflect. He was a complete racist. He was a complete racist in his personal views about Indians and especially their abilities in the field of architecture. And he said, after doing a complete survey of India, After having seen the exquisite pieces of architecture, and many of them a product of that unimaginably creative synthesis of Indo-Muslim architecture, he said, "There is no architecture worth its name in India, only," and I quote, "veneered joinery in stone, concrete, and marble on a gigantic scale, but no real architecture, and nothing is built to last, not even the Taj Mahal." Of course, about classical Indian dance, which goes back literally to the dawn of time, the view of most Britishers was that it is nothing more than notch, which is looked upon with great derogation. Now, I just quoted these examples to you in order to make the point that this denunciation of the culture of the ruled continued for decades, if not centuries, and it then created a corpus of institutional derision. And the tragedy was, and this is the point that we need to think about, the tragedy was that it was internalized in some form or the other by the ruled, because it was something which was part of prescribed texts. It was something which aspiring clerks learnt to mug up before they gave the exams. And therefore, it created two things. It created an alienation to your own culture and a sense of awe, if not respect, but a sense of awe for the culture of the rulers. The second instrument in the field of colonialism was to create an education system, deliberately and consciously, for the production of competent but submissive clerks. Because that was the need for the colonial rulers at that time. And therefore, again, it was that great seer who pronounced the intention with such amazing clarity that I think in London they should build a statue for him right in front of Buckingham Palace. He said very simply, in a minute, which was then adopted by the Supreme Council of the then East India Company. He said, and it was quoted, but it needs to be quoted again, because you have to see the intention behind it. "We must at present do our best to form a class who may be interpreters between us and the millions we govern. A class of persons, Indians in blood and color, but English in taste, in opinions, in moral, and in intellect." This was quoted by Mr. Idris, but it deserves to be remembered again. And this class would in time become by degrees fit vehicles for conveying our knowledge to the great mass of the population. So the first was an institutional devaluation of the culture of the rule. The second was the creation of an education system suited to the purpose of the colonizers, and therefore it created in bulk as part of standard curricula, as part of the aim set for education, passable draftsmen, but not policy makers, interpreters of policy, but not innovators. It created the cram and vomit kind of ethos for educational systems, the emphasis on exams, and of course, no independent thinking. And the third prong of this colonial strategy, and this is a subject which I feel very strongly about, but it would be left to the conference to give it the importance it needs, was language. Wangari Maathai was in Delhi, the Nobel laureate from Kenya, and I had occasion to meet with her, and she told me, and then said it in a public speech, that the colonizers instinctively knew what is most precious to the ruled. And therefore, the first thing they took away from the ruled was their language.